From opening Pandora's box to killing Medusa, here are the top 6 stories from Greek mythology. Number 6. Pandora's Box. Everyone knows you shouldn't open Pandora's box, but do you know exactly why? Who's Pandora, and where'd she get the box in the first place? The story of Pandora begins with a feud between the gods. Zeus had given Prometheus and Epimetheus the job of creating all life on Earth. Kind of a big responsibility, and they had to be pretty creative. While Epimetheus focused on the animals, Prometheus opted to focus all of his attention on humans. By the time he had finished creating humans, Prometheus wanted to give them something for protection and asked Zeus if he could give them fire. Zeus refused, as fire was only for the gods, but Prometheus went behind his back and gave it to us anyway. Thank goodness. As punishment for this betrayal, Prometheus was sentenced to everlasting torture. Since the humans had accepted fire, they were given a woman named Pandora. She looked like the goddess Aphrodite and received the gifts of wisdom, beauty, kindness, peace, generosity, and health. She was to marry Epimetheus, who did a great job making all the animals and didn't get into trouble. As a wedding present, Zeus gave her a box that she was warned never to open. Uh-oh, what kind of a gift is that? You know we can't resist the call of the mystery box. As is human nature, Pandora kept looking at the beautiful box and thought that it couldn't hurt to just peek inside. When she opened the box, she released all of life's miseries out into the world. Greed, envy, pain, hatred, disease, hunger, war, and death. In a last-ditch attempt, she slammed the lid back down. As she did so, only one thing remained in the box for humans to control, and that was hope. From then on, we would be able to harness the power of hope to overcome all of the suffering that had already been released into the world. You just had to open it, didn't you, Pandora? Number 5. Odysseus and the Cyclops. After spending 9 years at the Battle of Troy, the triumphant Odysseus and his men set sail for home, but on their way, they were blown off course. It would take them years and many obstacles before they could get back. At one point, they came across an island, and looking for some respite from their journey, they decided to make landfall. Little did they know, this island was the home to the Cyclops people, giants who had one eye in the middle of their forehead who loved to eat humans. The sailors found a cave full of food and drink and proceeded to help themselves. After falling asleep, they were awoken by the return of the Cyclops, Polyphemus, who led his flock of sheep into the cave and rolled a massive boulder across the entrance. Upon finding the humans, the Cyclops angrily smashed 2 of them against a rock before eating them, and then he fell asleep. Terrified, the rest of the sailors tried to leave, but there was no way out. The next morning, the Cyclops woke up, ate another 2 of Odysseus's men, and then took his sheep out, again closing the cave behind him. At this point, Odysseus devised a plan. He and his men found a large log and sharpened it at one end, then hid it. When the Cyclops returned that evening, he again ate 2 more men, but this time Odysseus spoke up and offered him some wine. Polyphemus had never drunk wine before, and he was soon stumbling around. He thanked Odysseus and asked his name, to which he replied, "No man." Drunk and happy, the Cyclops fell asleep. Odysseus and his men immediately set to work. They heated the spike in the fire until it was glowing red and then drove it into the eye of the Cyclops. He screamed, and as the other Cyclops of the island came to help, they asked what had happened and who had done this to him. He said, "No man has done this to me," at which point the others laughed and left. The next morning, the Cyclops opened his cave and felt each of his sheep as they left with him. Except this time, Odysseus and his men were clinging underneath them and managed to get away. They ran back to their ship and set sail once more, taunting the Cyclops as they left and letting him know that it was in fact Odysseus who had orchestrated the whole thing. Number 4. Perseus and Medusa. Perseus was the son of the god Zeus and the human woman Princess Danae. An oracle had told her father that her son, his grandson, would kill him, so he locked her away in a tower. Zeus discovered her and paid her a visit because, of course, she was quite beautiful, and Perseus was born. Later, the evil king Polydictes wanted to marry Danae, but feared Perseus would get in his way, so he sent him on a mission to retrieve the head of the Gorgon Medusa. Medusa was one of the 3 Gorgon sisters and the only mortal one. She was a priestess of Athena and devoted to a life of celibacy. Unfortunately, she was seduced by Poseidon, and in revenge, Athena punished her and turned her into a monster with live snakes covering her head. Anyone who dared to look at her face would be turned to stone. This was clearly quite the task that Perseus had been set, so he sought the help of Athena and Hermes. They gave him winged sandals to allow him to travel to the end of the world where the Gorgons lived, a cap of invisibility, an enchanted sword, and a mirrored shield. Upon arriving to their lair, Perseus made his way past the statues of previous adventurers who had suffered the fate of Medusa's gaze. The shield was his saving grace, as it allowed him to see her reflection without looking directly at her. He was able to sneak up to her and in one swipe cleanly cut off her head. He put her head in a bag and left quickly to avoid the wrath of her sisters and began his return home. When he arrived home, he found that his mother had been mistreated by King Polydectes. He entered the throne room where the king accused him of failing his task. So Perseus pulled the head from the bag, and the king and all of his cohorts were immediately turned to stone. Number 3. King Midas. King Midas had it all. He ruled over the country of Phrygia and had everything a king could ever want. But beyond the luxurious castle, extravagant food, and a beautiful daughter that would one day rule, the only thing he truly cared about was his gold. He would spend most of his days counting his gold and covering himself in it, bathing in it. He was pretty obsessed. One day, a friend of Dionysus, the god of wine and revelry, found himself stuck in the kingdom, and Midas, immediately recognizing him, offered him a welcome place to stay for a few days before returning home. Dionysus was extremely grateful for the way his friend had been treated and promised to grant the king one wish. The king said, "I wish that everything I touch turns to gold." Midas was warned to think carefully about his wish, but he was adamant. Dionysus reluctantly agreed, and the next day, everything Midas touched would turn to gold. Waking up in the morning, Midas was excited to test out his new power. He touched a table that immediately turned to gold, then a chair, his door, and his bathtub. He was elated. He ran through his castle, turning everything to gold until he became hungry and sat down to eat. He tried to eat a grape, but it too turned to gold. The same with a slice of bread. It was at this point he realized the mistake he had made. He began crying, and his daughter came to see what was wrong. He hugged her, and she turned into a golden statue. He cried out to Dionysus, who took pity on the poor king. He told him to wash his hands in the Pactolus River, which is now famous for its gold. He did this and saw gold flowing from his hands as the waters passed. When he returned home, everything had turned back to normal, and he was pretty relieved. From that point on, Midas decided to share his fortunes with his people. He became a kind and generous king and became grateful for all he had in his life. See, all is well that ends well. Number 2. Theseus and the Minotaur. King Minos of Crete had a problem. His wife, Pasiphae, had cheated on him, sleeping with a bull that had been sent by Zeus. She became pregnant and gave birth to the Minotaur, a half-man, half-bull monster. Embarrassed by the affair but unwilling to kill the Minotaur, King Minos decided to hide it in the labyrinth underneath the palace of Knossos. He would throw his enemies into the labyrinth for the Minotaur to eat, and since the labyrinth was impossible to escape, it was a good way to deal with all those who opposed him. Not really a fatherly thing to do, but you know. A few years later, Minos' son, Androgeus, was killed during a marathon in Athens by the same bull that had fathered the Minotaur. So angry was the king that he insisted that the king of Athens, Aegeus, would send 7 men and 7 women every year to the labyrinth as punishment for what had happened. On the 3rd year, Aegeus' son, Theseus, volunteered to be one of the 7 men sent and promised to slay the Minotaur. Theseus told this to King Minos before entering his labyrinth, but the king wasn't worried. Even if he did manage to kill the Minotaur, he would never be able to find his way out. At the same time, Theseus met Minos' daughter, Princess Ariadne, and they fell in love. She gave him a ball of yarn to unravel as he journeyed through the labyrinth so he could find his way back out. He followed her advice, and after finding and killing the Minotaur, he was able to easily find his way back out and return to Crete with his new love. There was, of course, a sad ending to this story. Theseus had agreed with his father that on his return he would change the color of the sails of the ship to show that he was still alive. The night before returning, he, his crew, and Ariadne celebrated with a wild feast. She overslept the next morning and didn't make it back to the boat before they left. Theseus only realized this once it was too late, and in his misery he forgot to change the sails. His father, upon seeing the return of the ship but thinking that his son had died, jumped to his death from the cliffs into what is now known as the Aegean Sea. Number 1. Jason and the Golden Fleece. Jason was the rightful heir to the kingdom of Iolcus, but his uncle Peleus had stolen the throne from his father. Fearful that he would lose grip on his power, Peleus had Jason's father locked up, and to save his life, Jason's mother smuggled him out of the city where he was raised by a centaur. When he was old enough, Jason set out to regain what was rightfully his. At the same time, a plan was being hatched by Hera, the wife of Zeus. She hated King Peleus as he had honored all of the gods except for her. She decided to take the throne away from him, but to do this, she needed a hero. Jason was the obvious choice, but she first needed to test him to ensure that he was up to the task. What followed were a series of trials for Jason, who lived up to expectations at every turn. His uncle realized what a threat Jason was. He asked him over dinner, "How would you go about getting rid of someone who was giving you difficulties?" Jason replied, "Send him after the Golden Fleece." So Uncle Peleus did just that. Jason gathered a crew known as the Argonauts and set sail in search of the fleece. It proved to be a long journey, full of trials and troubles along the way. Jason lost most of his crew, but eventually found himself in Colchis, the land of the Golden Fleece. The king of Colchis, Aedes, said that he could have the fleece, but only if he completed three tasks. The first was to rake a field using fire-breathing oxen. He was then to sow dragon's teeth into the soil and defeat the magical warriors that would sprout. Then all he would need to do was defeat the dragon that guarded the fleece. Easy peasy. The gods, wanting Jason to succeed, made Aedes' daughter, Medea, fall in love with him, and she helped him with each of the trials. He completed them in no time with her help, and after spraying a sleeping potion in the dragon's face, managed to get the fleece and escape. Following further difficulties on their way home, including the mythical sirens and giant bronze man, Jason and his remaining crew finally made it back to Greece. He held the fleece high and entered the city to take the throne from Peleus. Of course, his uncle wasn't willing to hand over control to Jason, so it was left to his now wife, Medea, to cast a spell on Peleus' daughters that would make them attack him before she dealt the fatal blow that killed him. Jason finally took his rightful place as king. Thanks for watching. Remember to subscribe, and I'll see you next time.